Today we're going to be talking about antennas in the context of space, so antennas for space application, and we will go through one of the most important procedures which needs to be taken care of, namely the link budget. So we will discuss what determines how good a link is, what determines how many errors we're going to get, and what determines how good a connection is, and specifically for several satellite applications, we're going to do some examples and look at how this is all realized. Now, before going into this, before going into the new things and the details, let's remember a few things from the previous lessons. So first of all, let's remember the concept of directivity. A few sections ago, we spoke about directivity as a measure of how much the antenna, if you like, directs and concentrates energy in a specific direction as opposed to the rest. So you define the directivity as the maximum value of the directive gain or the peak in the directive gain diagram. And we said that it can be given through a ratio of surfaces, which is given like 4 pi times the effective surface of the antenna divided by the square of the wavelength. So this effective surface, one important note to make here again, is that this effective surface may not be the physical surface area of the antenna. So if we have an aperture antenna, like a dish, then it is related to the actual surface area, but we may be having a whip antenna. So we may have an antenna which is essentially a stick. And in that case, this A, this surface area, it carries the properties of the antenna, and it's a constant which characterizes the antenna. And again, it has the effective dimension of surface area, but it is not literally the surface area of the little whip. So it's an effective area. Now, typically the antennas we use, we have their effective areas, we have the wavelength in which they're going to work, and so we can calculate the directivity for them. Now, one important distinction to make right now is between directivity and gain. So what we're going to call the gain of an antenna is actually not just the directivity, but the directivity times the efficiency of the radiation. So any antenna, for that matter, any interface between confined waves and free waves, free propagating waves, any such interface is going to have some losses. So you cannot take a confined wave from a waveguide and perfectly transmit it. You will always have some losses, and we're going to take into account these losses in this eta turn here. So eta rad, it's the radiation efficiency. It is the efficiency or a coefficient between 0 and 1, which tells us what part of the directivity actually turns into the gain. So if we had a perfect efficiency, if we had a 1, then the gain and the directivity would be the same thing. But in reality, we never have perfect efficiency, and so the gain is slightly less than the directivity. Now, keeping this in mind, there is a very important quantity which we should think of right now, because we do not know how a general directive diagram, we don't know how it generally recedes with distance. We compute it for a dipole antenna, how the radiation pattern decays with distance, so how it drops the total power flux, but we do not know how the power flux drops for a general pattern. And so what we should do is actually assume that we have an ideal isotropic radiator which is equivalent to our antenna in the given direction. So again, what we can do is, instead of actually knowing exactly how our radiation pattern, if you like, propagates in space and how the power flux decays with distance, we can assume that since we're looking at a specific direction, we can replace our pattern mathematically, we can replace it with a perfect isotropic radiator, so spherical fronts, which we know how they decay, and the power which they would need to have is equal to the gain times the power of our transmitter. So if we have the direction which is, again, the highest power direction, the peak in our directive gain area, we compute the gain from that. So we compute the directivity, we multiply by the losses, we get the gain, and this gain, we multiply the total power emitted by the antenna by this gain, and we get what would be the equivalent power of an isotropic radiator which had the same power as our non-isotropic antenna in the same direction. So this EIRP, which is equal to the gain times the total power, this is the equivalent isotropic radiator. So equivalent isotropic radiator power is equal to our power times the gain in the direction we're considering. So you can see the idea behind this whole thing is that we know exactly how the power flux of a spherical front decays. We know that the power flux of a spherical isotropic antenna, so perfect spherical fronts, it is simply the total power divided by the surface of the sphere. And so, since we're looking at a very specific direction, we don't really care about the pattern outside of this direction, and we can approximate our real antenna with an equivalent isotropic radiator. Now, having this quantity, having computed this quantity, and knowing exactly how the radiation decays, if we had now two antennas, this time considering emission and receiving, we can immediately tell how much power is going to be received if we know the distance between our antenna and the receiver. Let's say we're emitting with a total power of PT, it goes for P transmission. We know that the EIRP, or the equivalent isotropic radiated power, is equal to this PT, so the emission power, times our gain. And we know that this EIRP is equivalent to an isotropic radiator emitting, and so we know that a distance r away from it, the power will have dropped by, you know, in a denominator by 4 pi r squared. And so we can compute the power which is going to reach our receiver. This P subscript r is the power of the receiver, and it's equal to the isotropic power, so the equivalent power that an isotropic antenna would receive, divided by 4 pi r squared, because the spherical fronts are getting larger and larger and the flux reducing by the surface of the sphere at which we're emitting, and multiplied by the area of the receiver. So why the effective area? Because PR is the power received, and the EIRP divided by the surface is the power flux. So multiplying the power flux by the effective area of the receiver, we get the total power received. And you can see here that the larger the receiver is, of course, the more power it is going to collect. So writing out the term EIRP, as we did before, so the power transmitted times the gain of the transmit antenna, what we get is this simple formula. So we get PT, GT, AE, power of transmission, gain of transmission, surface of receiver, divided by 4 pi r squared. So we see that the power of the receiver, the power that the receiver gets, is again decaying quadratically. So if it goes twice as far, it's going to receive four times less. Now there is a very nice way of writing this in terms of the properties of the antennas. And this is by recalling that the effective area is connected to the gain. So since we defined the gain, or more precisely the directivity, as the ratio, the surface area divided by lambda squared, we can substitute the effective area of the receiver with the gain of the receiver once taking into account its losses as well. So this all enters into the effective area. Now substituting this in terms of the gain of the receiver and the gain of the transmitter, we get this very simple formula. So for the power of the receiver, the power which is received by an antenna r distance apart is equal to the power of the transmitter times the gain of the transmitter times the gain of the receiver times the square of the wavelength and divided by 4 pi r, the whole thing squared. So we get this simple looking formula, and you may wonder, why did we get a dependence on wavelength? Shouldn't all electromagnetic waves decay in the same way with distance? We didn't have any dependence on wavelength. The reason is that we have actually included everything in terms of the properties of the antenna. So we have changed, instead of having the formula in terms of the area, we have changed it in terms of the gain. And since the gain is a function of the wavelength, this is where this lambda comes from. So it's not that actual electromagnetic waves in vacuum decay differently, their flux drops in the same way, 1 over r squared, but we have this wavelength coming simply because of the way we're writing the formula in terms of gains. We said earlier that more preferential are the units of dBs. So we said that everything is actually much easily computed, much more easily computed in terms of decibels, because especially in radio electronics, we're dealing with very, very huge differences in terms of powers. So you could have something in the order of 10 to the power of minus 12, 10 to the power of 12, and you have orders of magnitudes of different powers of 10, since we have different wavelengths, we have different power, and essentially computing by multiplication and division is actually much more tiresome, and a very nice way to do it is with logarithms. So this is where the naturality of dBs come from. And if you recall, when we were defining the gain of an antenna, we actually defined it in terms of dBi. So we defined it in terms of dBs with respect to an isotropic antenna. In this light, we have actually turned everything in our formula into dBs, into decibels, and the formula looks even simpler in this way. So the power in dB watts, so decibel watts, is equal to the power of the transmitter in dB watts, plus the gain of the transmitter in dBi, plus the gain of the receiver in dBi, minus 10 times logarithm 10 of this ratio, which is 4 pi r divided by lambda, and the whole thing is squared. So this is the loss term, and the minus sign is there since it was in the denominator. So if we look at everything now, this equation is much simpler to compute, because we only have subtraction and addition. So this is the power of dBs, this is the power of dB notation, of logarithm notation, because it turns multiplication into addition, and it turns division into subtraction. And so those relatively ugly looking formulas with very large or very small numbers, they turn into something much more easy to compute and much more manageable and easy to imagine in a sense. This formula is known as Frees' equation of propagation, and you can look at it in the following way. It tells you if you have two antennas, if you have a link, and if you're receiving from the transmitter, essentially the power you're going to get, it depends on the power of the transmitter, obviously, the gains of both the transmitter and the receiver, so how much the antennas focus that energy, and it is counter-proportional, or in terms of dBs, it is subtracting the losses due to the propagation. So this last term, this is the losses term. So this is known as free space loss. The reason why it's known like this is because we have propagation, and in a sense you could think of it as the free space reducing the power of the signal. So we have seen how this is derived. We have seen that the wavelength there is simply a relic of the fact that we're using the gains, but this formula is actually very useful, and it's much, much simpler to use than the general. Now, a few more words about losses. We have defined losses essentially again in dBs, and we have defined them in decibel notation. So in this equation which we just got, the Frees equation, we can easily subtract any other losses we may have. Now, our convention is to add all of the powers, all of the gains, so everything that improves the signal, and to subtract any losses. So in the same equation, if we considered additional losses, we can just subtract them as well. And for example, those can be so we already have the free space losses due to the propagation itself, but we could have atmospheric attenuation, so we could have polarization mismatch, we could have some sort of snow or different atmospheric problems, and all of these losses, we should simply subtract them, however many dBs they are, and we get the final result for the power in dB watts. Now, just to get a feel for how this procedure works and to see exactly what it looks like to actually compute these things and how much easier it is in terms of decibel notation, let's get a very simple example solved. So let's suppose we have a satellite in geosynchronous orbit, so geosatellite, and the geosynchronous orbit is roughly 36,000 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. So suppose we have a ground station exactly on the equator, and the distance between us, so our receiving antenna, and the satellite which is transmitting, the distance is exactly 36,000, roughly 36,000. Suppose the satellite has a gain of the antenna of about 20 dBi, and our receiver on the ground has a gain of about 35 dBi. Okay? And suppose we're transmitting a total power of 700 watts at 10 gigahertz. So our frequency is 10 gigahertz. Now, what does that tell us? If we simply plug into all of those formulas, if we plug our current results, and you can do this very easily, we're gonna get that the total free space losses are approximately 203.5 dBs. So we get a very large number in terms of something which is a logarithm. Now, the power of transmission, so those 700 watts, when we convert them to dB watt notation, there are 28.5 dB watts. This is easy to compute. So 10 times logarithm base 10 of 700, you can easily find this 28.5 roughly. So Keeping all of these in mind, we can immediately compute the power in terms of dB watts. So the power received by us on the ground, the PR, is going to be equal to 28.5, which is the original power transmitted by the satellite, plus 20, which is the gain of the satellite antenna, plus 35, which is the gain of our antenna, so our ground station's antenna, and minus 203.5. So we are adding the two gains of the antennas, we're adding the total power with which the satellite is emitting, and we are subtracting 203.5 dBs, which is the free space propagation losses. And I have also subtracted 5 more dBs for any additional noises. So, for example, 3 of those could be due to polarization mismatch, and 2 of those can be for some sort of attenuation of the atmosphere. So we get something like minus 125 dB watts for received power. Now you may wonder, okay, we got it in dB watts, but what does this mean? And it's very easy now to actually turn it back into watts. So once having computed everything in dBs, the easier way, let's say, we can easily go back to watts only and simply reverting back. Okay, so from the formula, we can easily see that going from dBs to regular units, it simply means dividing by 10 and then raising to the power of 10. And what we get is actually just a few picowatts. So you get the received power is only going to be, in fact, less than a single picowatt. So this is 10 to the power of minus 12. This is incredibly small. So this is 1,000 times less than nanowatt. It's a millionth of a millionth of a watt. So it's very, very little. And okay, you may think this is very, very small as a quantity, so we get a millionth of a millionth of a watt in terms of power, but is that good is the real question. So is this useful? So what if we have learned how to compute the power received? Is this useful for our communication? Do we know if we have a good communication? And the answer is that we have no clue, because absolute power itself is not really important. What is important is its ratio to the noises. And this is the next thing which we're going to see. So what we have learned so far is how to compute the power received, but this tells us nothing about the quality of the communication itself. It tells us only an absolute value of power, which can mean anything depending on the noises themselves. And so the next section we're going to look at is exactly how to determine if this is sufficient and how to compare it to the noises and tell if our communication is actually good or not good enough.